Our first one is from Chris, and here's his question. I have heard your teaching that the creation accounts are not scientific descriptions, but polemics using pre-modern ancient Near Eastern cosmology. That makes perfect sense. Do you read the account of Noah's flood in the same way? Namely, that the setting assumes certain ancient Near Eastern conceptions, a geography, cosmology.
Yeah, this actually takes us into territory where, you know, one of the online courses I teach, the first assignment is always to do a word study on the terminology in the flood story. And students are assigned, you know, I don't care what position they take, but the assignment is, can a local or regional flood view be defended exegetically, you know, from the text? And so part of what I want them to see, what I want them to ask themselves when they go through that assignment, is really to think about context. Now, I say that to get us into the subject, because I'd say the account presumes the known world at the time, which would mean it isn't global like we think of global. So it's not about taking certain parts of the description and saying, oh, the mountains, you know, here, do they do this or that? Is this how people would have looked at mountains? Or look, it's just the world at the time is given to us in the Bible, and specifically it's given to us in Genesis 10. So really, one of the key questions, you know, to approaching this question and just generally interpreting the flood account is Genesis 10 the correct context or part of the correct context for interpreting Genesis 6 through 8? And if you're not familiar with Genesis 10, Genesis 10 gives us the nations known to the biblical writers. It actually lists them out. And you're not going to find nations elsewhere in the Bible that are found outside the geographical parameters. In other words, it's basically the world of the Mediterranean, you know, a little bit maybe beyond what, you know, what the Greeks knew as the Pillars of Hercules and all that stuff, you know, into what is now Spain and stretching over toward, you know, what is India, but basically the Mediterranean world, which includes parts of Africa, you know, Middle East, and again out stretching out toward, you know, what might be the northernmost parts at most, you know, of India or something like that. But that's the known world at the time. And so Genesis 10 lists a bunch of nations. If you plot them on a map, like you can get any Bible software, any study Bible, that this is the picture that's going to emerge. So the question is, should that chapter inform our understanding of how we read the flood account? And I would say, yeah, it should, because those nations are the ones that extend from Noah's sons that survive the flood. So if that's part of our context, then it's very evident that we should be reading, you know, the biblical flood in light of that context. So I'm not talking about science, or the, you know, science isn't even on the table here. We're just asking, what is the correct context for the biblical writer? So if you're gonna look at that, well, it's kind of obvious, you know, that this is their world to them, and if they're writing about a flood that affects, you know, this region, then for the writer, that's the world, quote unquote. But we know, again, that it's not the globe, you know, because there's lots of other nations like Australia, North and South America that aren't in these within these parameters. Now, beyond that, you know, there are other things to consider here that people often don't think about as far as, you know, how to approach the flood narrative. I would say we need to also consider the vocabulary of the flood account. This is where that assignment that I give people in this class, you know, comes in, especially the phrases that those who take a global view, in other words, they want to read the flood account, you know, and say it's global like we think. There are certain phrases that sort of drive that argument. And I ask people to fix, you know, their minds on those phrases, because there's more to them than what you would think. Now, you know, before I go on here, you could argue that, well, the intent of the passage of the flood description, the intent was, you know, all the world. And so we could take that the flood story and say, well, we're gonna use the intent as sort of the context by which to frame the discussion. Okay, you know, that certainly, you know, could be on the table. But if you just take, you know, Genesis 10 by its lonesome, and use that as the context for interpreting the flood, then you're going to come out with a local or regional event. So there's, you know, these are interpretive decisions. These are hermeneutical decisions. Neither thing is totally self-evident, you know, in how we should think about what we're thinking about, you know, when it comes to this. But anyway, you know, back to the phrases. What I'm talking about here is phrases like all the earth or the whole heaven or all flesh. These are phrases that take the word kol in Hebrew, all, every, or whole is what it means. And then it combines it with a word like eretz, land or earth, or basar, flesh, you know, all flesh, you know, all earth, the whole earth, all the earth, or shemayim, the whole heavens, or something like that. If you search those identical phrases through the Hebrew Bible, you will find the identical phrases occur a number of times. And within those hits, there are clear instances where the context dictates that the phrase should not be understood in terms of exhaustive totality. Let me give you some examples. Let's go with kol and eretz, okay, all the earth or the whole earth. Shows up in Genesis 2:11. This is the description of, you know, Eden, the name and the four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon. It flows around the whole kol land, eretz, all the earth of Havilah, where there is gold. Well, are we really being asked to believe that every place in Havilah was infiltrated by this river, like every square inch of it, you know, is you know, runs, there's a tributary or something, some part of this river that runs through it? Well, obviously not, or you wouldn't really have any arable, you wouldn't have any dry land. Are we supposed to say that, you know, the kol eretz of Havilah, again, all the land of Havilah, was surrounded by this river? In other words, the river surrounded the entire region, the entire place called Havilah? Again, you can't get exhaustive totality in the context of that verse. It occurs in Genesis 2:13, where it's the Gihon, again, these four rivers with Eden. 1 Samuel 14:25. Here's the verse. And all kol, the land, eretz, all the earth, all the land entered the forest, and there was honey on the ground. Now, the word kol, again, presumes people here in the context. They're talking about, you know, a mass of people going into the forest, okay? So are we to presume that every last person of the earth, of the land, or let's just make it the land of Israel to not be ridiculous, but every last person in the land of Israel went into that forest? Well, of course not. You know, obviously not. You know, Isaiah 14:7, the whole kol, earth, eretz, is at rest and is quiet. Really? Like no human or animal in the entire globe was making a sound? I mean, you could just go on and on, you know, with these sorts of phrases. Abraham to Lot, Genesis 13:9, is not the whole kol, land, eretz, the whole earth, the whole land before you? No, I would suggest it wasn't, because Lot isn't looking at the entire globe, nor could he. Lot's not standing there with Abraham and seeing Australia. So these phrases, in many places, do not, they cannot speak to exhaustive totality. The same thing with kol basar, all flesh. So we have here, let me just, you know, run a search here and look at a few of these. Joel 2:28. Let's just take a look at one here. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, kol basar. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. If you're going to say that that's exhaustive totality, then every person on earth is going to receive the Holy Spirit. But that isn't the case. Only believers do. So, but this phrase, again, is something that occurs right in the Genesis account. So I would suggest, you know, again, I don't really care. This is on my list of issues that I have to muster interest to really care about whether someone is a global flutter or a local regional flutter. I don't really care. I only care when people tie it to salvation or someone's view of inerrancy, because I can go for a long time going through, you know, scripture. I could be standing in front of an auditorium full of people and just running searches and showing you the exact phrases in context where they cannot mean exhaustive totality. And then the question is very simple. is it okay to take these instances of these phrases where they don't mean exhaustive totality? Is it okay to use them as the hermeneutical filter then for the flood account and argue for a regional flood? People would say, no, no, that's illegitimate. You can't do that. And then it's very easy. I could just say, well, of course I can, because of Genesis 10. Genesis 10 is not all the nations of the globe. It's all the nations that they knew, which is regional. Again, it's not difficult to argue for a local regional event and have a really text-based argument for that that has nothing to do. I didn't even bring up science. I don't care what science says. I'm not a scientist. Doesn't amount a hill of beans to me. I don't use science as a hermeneutical tool. What I just gave you was text-based information. You know, we could go to the chronology of the flood account. Here's one. You know, I'll be done with this after this. I don't want to belabor it too much. But if you look at the flood account, now listen, I'm going to read a few verses to you. See if you catch a problem here. Genesis 8:3, the water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of 150 days, the water had gone down. And in verse 5, Genesis 8, we read, and the water decreased steadily until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains became visible. Next verse, then it came about at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. And he sent out a raven, and it flew here and there until the water dried up from the earth. Okay, that was verse 7. Now I'm in verse 8. Then he sent out a dove from him to see if the water was abated from the face of the land. Next verse. But the dove found no resting place for the sole of her foot. So she returned to him into the ark, for the water was on the face of all the earth, the kol eretz. Then he put out his hand and took her and brought her into the ark himself. Now, do you see the problem? Genesis 8:9 tells us that the water was on the face of all the earth, the kol eretz. But 40 days earlier, the water had receded sufficiently for the mountains to be visible. And so the water wasn't really on the face of the entire earth. The face of the entirety of the earth was not covered in Genesis 8:9, even though that's the way the language sort of makes it sound. Kol eretz. So even here, the vocabulary, this phrase, does not mean exhaustive totality. Again, I could go a long time, you know, going through stuff like this. I don't really care. I don't make it an issue of, you know, my own, you know, how I look at, you know, somebody's, you know, commitment to inspiration or anything like that. But a lot of people do. And all I'm saying is, you know, that's kind of a mistake to do that. So I hope that illustrates the question and also answers it, but illustrates it. That it's not just an ancient Near Eastern thing, even though the cosmology is part of it, the sort of pre-modern cosmology, that's part of the picture. But part of the picture as well, if you want to argue for a local regional view, this is how you would do it. I just modeled it for you. This is how you would make a text-based argument for it, using the text of Scripture to do so. But, you know, I don't really care one way or the other.